Good afternoon. It is my pleasure to introduce our main speaker for today, Professor Scott Pei, who is Professor of Religious Studies at DePaul University in Chicago. He holds a PhD in Theological Ethics from Princeton Theological Seminary and a Master of Divinity from Andover Newton Theological School. Working in the fields of Christian ethics and public theology, Professor Pei has published widely on contemporary issues related to ethics of war and peace, as well as religious perspectives on business ethics and medical ethics, ranging from topics such as the pension crisis to the war in Iraq. He's the author or editor of 8 books and numerous articles, which include, most recently published in 2013, The Niebuhr Brothers for Armchair Theologians, published in 2010, Public Theology for a Global Society, Essays in Honor of Max Stackhaus, and also other works such as Exodus Church and Civil Society, Public Theology and Social Theory in the work of Jürgen Moltmann, Who Do You Say I Am? Christology and Identity in the United Church of Christ, Religious Perspectives on Business Ethics, and The Local Church in a Global Era, Reflections for a New Century. Professor Pave is currently co-editor of the Journal of the Society of Christian Ethics, and he has lectured around the world, including Lebanon, India, and New Zealand. Besides his contributions to the academic profession, Professor Pave is also an ordained minister in the United Church of Christ, and he has worked with a wide variety of organizations, including Interfaith Playdate, Chicago Interfaith Local Justice, and the Confessing Christ National Steering Committee. A prolific author and a popular speaker, he has written editorials to a number of newspapers and was featured on PBS Religion and Ethics News Weekly. Professor Pave is currently working on a number of research projects, including a book in progress entitled Christianity and the Economic Crisis. Our respondent is Professor Christine Powell, and she is Associate Professor of Theology at the University of Chicago Divinity School and in the college, and also Dean of the Disciples Divinity House, a position she has held since 1991. Professor Cobb works primarily in the area of constructive theology, where she focuses on feminist and womanist theologies, the use of fiction in theological thinking, and issues on ecclesiology, as well as protest and resistance within a theological context. She is the author of Vulnerability and Glory, which is one of the first theological works to explore the connections between theological anthropology and environmental and economic vulnerability within a multidisciplinary setting. She is the editor of a collection of writings by H. Richard Niebuhr entitled The Responsibility of the Church for Society and Other Essays, in which Niebuhr's writings on ecclesiology and Christian community are published for the first time. Professor Cobb has served on numerous boards in various executive and advisory roles, including as chair of the Council on Theological Education, a former president of the Association of Disciples for Theological Discussion, and she's also a founding member of the Forest Moss Institute and Association of Disciples Women Scholars, and is a member of the Commission of Faith and Order of the World Council of Churches. As a senior scholar of the Enhancing Life Project, sponsored by the John Templeton Foundation, Professor Cobb is currently working on a monograph that engages historical theological debates about the glory of creation and human things, the aim of which is to foster critical sensibilities about what it means to be fully alive in the midst of contemporary challenges facing our world today. And will you now please join me in welcoming Professor Scott Pei and Christine Cobb.
Participate in a conversation of the kind that we're having, and it's particularly humbling to be wrapping up the day after such a really impressive series of papers and presentations, of which I suspect that mine may very well be the least. I want to begin in a place where me and Professor Culp have a common intersection here, which is in a comment by H. Richard Niebuhr, who once commented that the first job of Christian ethics is to ask what's going on. And in my paper, I want to begin by looking at precisely that question, what's going on? Because the issue of how to define, let alone achieve, the common good within a pluralistic and at times highly divided society is by no means an easy question to answer. And unlike the current political realities, not only in the United States but around the world, one could be forgiven for believing that any genuine attempt to articulate a concept of the common good for a global society is doomed to failure. Obviously, this pessimistic assessment is not universally shared, and the basis for the idea of global ethic is rooted in the hope that the divisions which seem so stark in contemporary society are capable of being overcome or at least largely ameliorated within the context of some actually existing form of human society. Or alternatively, the idea of a global ethic represents an eschatological possibility against which we can measure the successes and failures of the actually existing societies in which we dwell. Either way, there is good reason for a degree of skepticism about its possibility given the current social and political trends around the world. Nevertheless, I want to argue for the importance not only of embracing the idea of a global ethic as a concrete normative possibility that should govern our conversations about how our social and particularly economic lives should be organized, but that such an ethic is crucial for thinking in a sustainable way about the prospects for a global common good. Without some form of global ethical framework, the very concept of a common good of any sort, let alone on the global level, is incoherent and incomprehensible. Thus, I want to think through the question of what it might mean to move from the idea of a global ethic to what it implies for the concept of the common good, to the concrete question of how these principles can serve as the basis of a prophetic critique of the global economy as it currently stands, in the hope that humanity is capable of embracing a prospective ethic of economic justice on a global scale for the sake of the common good of all humanity. Whatever grounds there may be for pessimism in the short run, unless we can instill a sense of optimism about the possibility of overcoming the divisions which beset global society in the long run, the alternatives are ultimately defeatist and perhaps nihilistic. The idea of a global ethic was initially given prominence in the Parliament of World Religions Declaration Toward a Global Ethic, which was drafted in 1993. This statement presented a set of affirmations about the nature of universal human morality, which cut across cultural and religious contexts and provides a foundational reference point for the development of a global ethical agenda capable of overcoming the evils of ecological decay, poverty, and social decay that threaten the Earth and its people. These affirmations attest to the belief held by the drafters of the Declaration that these principles, quote, offer the possibility of a better individual and global order and lead individuals away from despair and societies away from chaos, end quote. At the heart of the Declaration is the affirmation that, quote, there is an irrevocable, unconditional norm for all areas of life, for families and communities, for races, nations, and religions. There already exist ancient guidelines for human behavior which are founded on the teachings of the religions of the world and which are the condition for a sustainable world order. The Declaration emphasizes the centrality of human interdependency, the need for individual responsibility and respect for the life and dignity of all human beings as the core values that contribute to the development of a global ethic. As such, it presents itself as a normative framework rooted in an anthropology of human connection and cross-cultural intelligibility. In this sense, it positions itself against conceptions of incommensurable communities of moral discourse and affirms that there are certain things which we all share in common simply by virtue of the fact that we're human. And among these things are a set of guiding ethical principles. The first question that confronts any attempt to understand global ethics in its validity as a normative ethical framework. It's not for nothing that two of the most prominent theorists of global ethics, Hans Kuhn and Leonard Swidler, operate within the context of a Catholic conception of moral universalism. They take for granted not only that there can be a universal approach to morality that transcends all cultures and particular religious communities, but that the existence of such universals are intuitively available to humans qua humans. Kuhn argues in favor of a global ethic rooted in a universalistic moral framework derived from a process of dialogue. Furthermore, both Kuhn and Swidler understand their programs to be rooted in a postmodern paradigm that is cognizant of the historical and epistemological challenges of such universalism. Particularly with regard to religious claims, Kuhn insists on the continuing validity of metaphysical concepts to the construction of moral categories, stating that, quote, to neglect this universal human phenomenon in analysis out of laziness, ignorance, or resentment would be to fail to do justice to an essential dimension of human life and human history, whether one affirms it or denies it, end of quote. These approaches, however, fail to do justice to the fundamental challenge of constructing a global ethic on the basis of these or any broader foundations, which is the at times radical dissensus with regard to moral norms that actually governs people's behavior, particularly in the realms of politics and economics. The fact remains that there is not only a vast difference between how moral imperatives are framed and implemented between different cultures, but there is often a massive disagreement within particular communities. The primary alternatives often suggest it seem to fall into one of three possible categories. Either give up on moral universalism and retreat into particularist enclaves defined by the specific moral norms of those communities, or insist on moral universalism as a brute force fact of human life, ignoring moral dissensus as the symptom of ignorance or disordered loves, or simply to throw up one's hands and embrace the dissensus. Kuhn and Swidler are aware of the problem of moral dissensus, and both argue that global dialogue offers a possible solution to overcoming this impasse to the development of a global ethic. Swidler argues that dialogue functions in this sense as an epistemological paradigm that offers an alternative to either incommensurable dissensus or the brute force imposition of moral principles. He argues that even in a post-metaphysical context, quote, even those who claim to have no ultimate view of the universe, no metaphysics, do in fact have the most elusive kind of metaphysics, a covert one. However, by substituting a dialogical and relational epistemology for what he terms the monologic and exclusivist paradigm that has governed Western morality through the 19th century, we can develop a new set of conceptions that will allow us to make genuine knowledge claims about moral principles. Thus, he argues for a principle of what he terms deep dialogue, rooted in critical thinking. Yet, here again, we run against the problem of whether there can be said to be anything in the current climate that genuinely unites us, or if flux and chaos rule the day. There are grounds for pessimism, particularly when the general conception of civil cooperation is increasingly subverted by ideologies of violence and aggression. It remains an open question as to whether or not there is even the place to begin a dialogue between groups with vastly different worldviews and presuppositions. This is not to say that the argument for a global ethic has no role in the midst of such a fraught set of circumstances. On the contrary, it may be that the only hope for a new paradigm of moral discourse, only the hope for a new paradigm of moral discourse can provide the resources that will aid in overcoming the increasing threat of violence in many places around the world. Thus, the conversation around how a global ethic can be justified and supported, and what its contours are, and in what sense it is morally binding on individuals and communities is absolutely vital. But it needs to take place in the context of the conversation about moral pluralism generally, and the possibility of incommensurable moralities in particular. In sketching the groundwork for an authentic global ethic, Swidler and Kuhn each in their own ways develop an anthropocentric, dynamic, and organic conception of morality, while at the same time emphasizing the need for a minima moralia rather than a comprehensive and maximalist conception of ethics. In that effort, Swidler uses the golden rule as the starting point for a set of minimal ethical standards, arguing that it is the best candidate not only because it is widely represented in various forms globally among different cultures and religions, but that it is also realistic in that it emphasizes the dialectical dimension of morality as existing between the self and the other. And my conception of your good is rooted in my prior self-understanding of my own good. On the one hand, there is a great deal of support for the apparent universality of something resembling the golden rule as a moral norm across religions and cultures. On the other hand, particularly in a postmodern context, the idea that any moral rule, let alone that particular one, may be categorical, apodictic, and unconditioned, is subject to criticism. Nevertheless, this should not prevent adherents of a global ethic from building a set of minimal moral concepts on the scaffolding of that principle. However, rather than assuming its self-evident quality, a global ethic needs to be prepared to argue for and support that conclusion in the midst of arguments for incommensurability and radical dissensus. There is certainly no shortage of advocates in modern economic life for principles of pure egoism and self-interest, for whom the golden rule itself may be seen to be a delusional and immoral principle. There are too many disciples of Ayn Rand about these days for the possibility of any principle of altruism to go unchallenged. Nevertheless, if advocates of a global ethic are prepared to found morality on the grounding principle of the golden rule and to defend it against challenge, it can provide the substantive basis for beginning to imagine an ethic that serves as the foundation for a larger moral project, one dedicated to building a vision of the common good that can address the larger problems of social and economic justice, inequality, and economic degradation that are inescapable contradictions of life in the early part of the 21st century. Like the concept of global ethics, the idea of the common good is by no means free of controversy or challenge. Whether or not there is any good that can be properly called common in a global sense remains an open question. Nevertheless, what a global ethic offers is a foundation out of which a conception of the common good can be articulated and defended on the basis of these emergent values, embodied by dialogical processes through which that ethic is articulated. There are several vectors from which to contemplate a conception of the common good. Within liberal theory, the question of the common good is tied with an idea of the general will through which the well-being of the whole people is understood and articulated. Capitalist economic theory imagines the common good as ultimately expressed through the invisible hand of the market, whereby individual self-interest produces the best possible outcomes for all. The challenge of balancing individual liberty with the good of all is the perennial challenge of any theory of the common good that recognizes the possibility that such a purely libertarian concept of the good may not in fact produce the best possible outcome in all circumstances. The question then becomes the degree to which personal liberty must yield to the greater need of the whole of society. Part of the challenge of articulating a conception of the common good within a capitalist society is the quasi-religious character that the market has assumed in modern society. The idea that there may, in fact, be goods desirable by the whole of society that cannot be supplied by the market is deemed in conversation about public policy not simply mistaken, but often as apparently heretical, beyond the pale of serious discussion. Pope Francis speaks in Laudate Si of the deified market that poses a serious risk to the ecological integrity of the whole world. Theologian Harvey Cox, in commenting on this encyclical, writes about this as the religion of the market. Any sustainable conception of the common good, both in the sense of having the capacity to make a lasting impact on moral discourse and in the sense of providing resources to contribute to an ethic of environmental sustainability, needs to grapple with the counter-ideology of the market as religion. This is not the same thing as saying that capitalism must be abolished as the economic foundation of a prosperous society, but it is to say that the market ideology that deifies capitalist accumulation must be reined in by an overriding set of values that prioritizes social equality and ecological integrity. It is here that a global ethic can provide compelling resources for the development of such a set of values, precisely because it seeks to create a moral framework rooted in dialogue that works upwards from the grassroots. It can take into account the concerns of those who are marginalized by the market ideology and its concomitant in its commitments to preserving a system of distribution which provides massively disproportionate goods to those at the top of the ladder. In a real sense, what the Occupy movement attempted to articulate, fleetingly and often ineffectively, was exactly this kind of dissatisfaction with the workings of the market deity. What Occupy lacked, however, was a set of resources that would allow it to last past a single season of protest. Its commitments to decentralized and radically democratic discourse meant that it failed to produce an agenda that could motivate public policy on a large scale. And so it faded from public consciousness as soon as it was removed from the places of public protest that it had occupied. A global economic ethic, however, can provide a foundation for the development of a theory of the common good that succeeds at providing a set of principles around which a concrete political agenda can be organized and advocated. Kuhn attempted to articulate the grounds for such an agenda in his book, A Global Ethic for Global Politics and Economics. His proposal had two key elements. First, quote, the primacy of politics over the economy, and second, quote, the primacy of ethics over the economy and politics. Of the first principle, he writes that the market, quote, must be at the service of higher ethical and political goals, expressed in measures of a political order. However, the political order itself must be constrained by the demands of a global ethic. Thus, in order to develop a theory of the global common good, we must envisage a set of nested priorities. The economy, nested within a political order that is capable of constraining its excesses. The political order, nested in a moral framework that insists on the foundational values of universal human rights and responsibilities for each individual person, the collective whole, and the ecosystem to which we all belong. Such a set of nested priorities would enable us to articulate why massive divergences between the richest and poorest members of society, why the vast differences in well-being between those in the developed and those in the majority world, why the economic arrangements that concentrate both wealth and power in the hands of a relatively few within the global economy are unjust and inhumane. The 1993 Declaration put these concerns at the center of its agenda, highlighting the continuing problems of poverty and social inequality as vital problems to address in any set of policies arising from a global ethic, declaring that, quote, all over the world we find endless hunger, deficiency, and need. In broad programmatic terms, the Declaration goes on to insist that authentic humanity requires an economic system that reorients economic life toward human mutuality and away from the desire to dominate, that is rooted in an ethos of mutual respect and the just balance of interests within society, and creates a context for an economic life that emphasizes moderation and mutuality rather than accumulation and competition. Thus, within the context of an, albeit contested, global ethic, it is possible to construct a vision of the also contested common good that can provide resources for the development of a vision of social and economic justice that can motivate action in the realm of politics and policy. However, in order to arrive at that point, it is necessary to advocate for a global ethic as a form of prophetic critique of the status quo, particularly the moral status quo. As a prophetic critique, Global Ethics takes an obverse stance to the current moral climate and insists on itself as a radical alternative to things as they currently are. By prophetic critique here, I'm thinking in terms of Abraham Heschel's definition of prophecy as seeking to convey the present pathos of God, which is to say that from within the convergent traditions of Judaism and Christianity, the idea that God is actively involved with and concerned with the question of the just ordering of society, and that God speaks out on behalf of those who are poor, outcast, and marginalized within that society. It means, in the words of Alan Bozek, developing a kairos consciousness, or a prophetic alertness for the action of God in the midst of the human experience. Crucially for the question of the significance of a global ethic, it means recognizing that, quote, the crisis we are now facing is a global crisis, and thus the call to understand this moment as a kairos moment is for all humanity. If we are entering a stage where the crises that affect humanity, social, economic, and ecological, are potentially irrevocable and irrevocably disastrous for both society and the planet, then it becomes necessary to understand a global ethic as the oppositional discourse of those who refuse to continue to accept things as they are, who recognize the divine call to resistance against structures and institutions that sustain idols of individualism and private accumulation for their own sake. It means embodying a vision of the common good, rooted in a conviction that the moment for a new model of human community is upon us. And if we do not seize it, it will pass us by, in which case the prospect of moving from crisis to catastrophe increases substantively. Global inequality, even in spite of the apparent gains made in material well-being of the world's poorest, creates a vast gulf between the reality of those at the top of the socioeconomic ladder, both within nations and globally, and those at the bottom. The realities of the poorest are not even conceivable to the richest, and their experience has been engineered to avoid direct contact with the alternate reality of the impoverished. Thus, our own kairos moment demands of us in this particular time and place no less dedication to discerning the signs of our own time, responsiveness to the calling of the divine in our midst, and commitment to no less radical a transformation than that envisaged by other kairos movements in Central and South America, in South Africa in the 1980s, in Palestine. Each of these movements, then and now, sought to articulate a moral alternative to the status quo that went to the roots of our obligations to God, our neighbors, and ourselves. In this sense, prophetic speech is the language of dissent. It declares an unambiguous no to structures and systems that are turned against divinity and humanity. It stands in opposition to ideologies and political regimes that embody violence, oppression, and injustice. It declares on behalf of those whom the powerful and the privileged deem to be unimportant, unclean, and unworthy of consideration. Because of this, prophetic speech is and must be dangerous, because it speaks God's word in a godless situation. The question must then become whether or not a global ethic as it is currently constituted can serve as the foundation for this kind of a prophetic no, whether it can bring to consciousness the kind of status confessionis that emerged from the kairos of the interwar years or the anti-apartheid struggle. Can a global ethic not only be responsive to the eruption of the divine energy confronting us here and now, but can it speak a powerful and transformative word to the present situation? Is a global ethic simply a restatement of principles that already underlie and support the existing situation? Or does it contain an element of transformative anticipation that can lead toward a new, more just, more egalitarian, and less violent moment in which individuals can struggle together for the sake of the common good and for the sake of a sustainable environment. I believe that these elements of ecology, economic justice, and the overcoming of systems of violence and oppression are intertwined with one another. It is not possible to imagine a political system capable of producing a just, sustainable and just economy that is also committed to ethno-nationalism and ideologies of violence. In the same manner, it is not possible to imagine an economy that can become ecologically sustainable that does not reject personal self-enrichment and unlimited accumulation as ideological premises. Thus, a global ethic that is capable of providing a sustainable human community must address each of these issues both collectively and individually. That said, for the remainder of this paper, I want to focus on the question of global ethic and economic justice, not because I believe that it is meaningfully separated from these other intertwined issues, but because focusing on this issue is instructive in beginning to understand what a global ethic is capable of achieving and what it may not be. A number of thinkers have tried to tie together the concept of a global ethic within the larger question of economic globalization and the development of a theory of global economic justice. The United Nations Global Compact represents one influential approach to creating the conditions for economic justice on a transnational scale. Stated in terms of 10 broad principles, it seeks to ground economic justice in the larger question of human rights and ecological sustainability. As far as they go, these principles are salutary and indeed essential to the creation of economic justice. However, the UN Global Compact is too narrowly framed insofar as it focuses exclusively on the responsibilities of businesses to contribute to the creation of an economic system grounded in principles of human rights. Yet I would suggest the need for a deeper critique of the value systems that inform the very way in which we understand the relationship of business to labor, government, and civil society. If a global ethic is going to be capable of creating the foundation for a just and sustainable society, it needs to be capable of reconfiguring the relationship between work, property, and the resources for living. While this need not entail anything so radical as the abolition of private property, it will require reconceiving of property, not as an individual entitlement, but as a necessary component for the creation of the common good. Such an agenda would be consistent with the principles of a global ethic and with the underlying principles of human rights that support the UN Global Compact. Furthermore, I would suggest that such a reordering of the concept of property would result in a massive distribution of wealth away from the richest 1% or even 10% of the population toward the great number of people who could be directly benefited by access to greater resources, as well as rethinking the relationship between work and income, imagining an economic system in which the basic needs of all are supplied simply by virtue of their membership in society. To conclude, the fundamental question remains, however, is such a radical vision imaginable within the terms of a global ethic, or does it continue to operate within the main lines of the economic and political system that already exists? Is a global ethic a genuine alternative to the politics of violence and the economics of accumulation? Or does it have within it the capacity to empower a more revolutionary moral transformation within society? One which can do what it claims to desire, to create a more democratic, egalitarian, and sustainable society in which human life can be lived humanely, and for the sake of individual flourishing, but also for the sake of the flourishing of humanity as a whole. As the 1993 Declaration states, quote, "Earth cannot be changed for the better unless the consciousness of individuals is changed. Yet this is only possible through a transformation," this is further quote, "transformation in individual and collective consciousness, for the reawakening of our spiritual powers through reflection, meditation, prayer, or positive thinking. for a conversion of the heart. End of quote. May the kairos of the present moment lead us to a prophetic stance that can allow such transformation to take place for the sake of the earth and for the sake of the human communities that call it home. Thank you.
Let me begin with thanks to the organizers of the conference, and especially to Miriam Renault for conceptualizing the conference and for the invitation to be part of it. Thank you also to Herbert Lynn and to William Schweiker for presiding. And finally, thank you to Professor Pape for your compelling paper. Thank you for framing so clearly what is at stake in the possibility of a global ethic amidst the contradictions and convulsions of the economic and political order of the 21st century. Your astute and insistent analysis points us to the relation between a global ethic and a larger moral project dedicated to building a vision of the common good, and to how each is necessary for the creation of a, quote, more democratic, egalitarian, and sustainable society. The South African writer Otmant Dangord observed, "Our history is contained in the homes we live in, that we are shaped by the ability of these simple structures to resist being defiled." That we are shaped by the ability of these simple structures to resist being defiled. The quote is from his novel, Kafka's Curse. But I first encountered it on the wall of the District 6 Museum in Cape Town, South Africa. The museum, which is housed in a former Methodist church, preserves everyday artifacts like teacups and barber's implements. It preserves photos and memories from a municipal district that was founded in 1867 by a mixed community of freed slaves, merchants, artisans, laborers, and immigrants. Music, education, community life, small businesses, and communities of faith flourished in this district. However, in 1901, Black South Africans were forced out, and the remaining multicultural and multi-faith community came under increasing pressure, especially by the imposition of apartheid, and in 1966, was declared a white area under the 1950 apartheid legislation, and eventually 60,000 residents were forcibly removed from the district, and the area was bulldozed. Today, only a few buildings, including the former church, and a bulldozed field remain. The small museum preserves both a vision of the common good that was developed in a multicultural, multi-faith community, and a reminder of the precariousness of those efforts and of the necessity of resistance to defilement. Professor Pate's reference to South Africa and the place of Kairos in the anti-apartheid struggle called the quote to mind. And perhaps for us, shared common life that can be sheltered in simple homes, faith communities, and the businesses of that district offer also an image of a simple structure of another sort, the Parliament's global ethic, and what it might shelter. We are shaped, again, to say the quote, we are shaped by the ability of these simple structures to resist being defiled. As these opening comments perhaps suggest, I want to focus most of my response on Professor Pate's discussion of an advocacy for a global ethic as a form of prophetic critique of the status quo. I want to build on his comments by reflecting on the relation of prophetic critique to the protest of Protestant Christianity. I hope this strategy will also help serve the conference's purpose of bringing resources of specific religious traditions, in this case, Protestant Christianity, into conversation, deeper conversation, with the Parliament's declaration on a global ethic. So, If I understand correctly, the heart of Professor Pate's argument turns on three key points. And I'm going to restate, or at least there were three key points that helped me to understand where you were going. Maybe not be the three key points of the paper. But I want to restate those before turning to prophetic critique as a resource. First, he observes that a global ethic assumes the possibility of a universal human morality that is rooted in, this is a quote, rooted in anthropology of human connection and cross-cultural intelligibility. However, he argues that possibility cannot be assumed to be self-evident. Rather, in this post-metaphysical age, a global ethic has to emerge from a process of ground-up dialogue, be created by consensus, and be argued for in the midst of arguments from incommensurability and radical dissensus. When he was writing about consensus, it brought to mind processes that the Faith and Order Commission of the World Council of Churches goes by. It's a consensus process, and we have these little cards that are red or green, and we hold them up, whether we're warm toward an idea or cold toward an idea. It's a process of building consensus that has its distinct advantages and its distinct disadvantages, because you know not to propose certain things, say, about the status of women that the Orthodox participants are definitely going to be cold toward. But vice versa, you know, it works the same way on the other side as well. That very visible image of kind of consensus around a world of diverse Christians came to mind in also thinking about this consensus that's involved in the World Parliament document. Second, he distinguishes the role of a global ethic, which is minimalist, from that of a, quote, comprehensive and maximalist conception of ethics. I was helped by Miriam Renaud's opening comments this morning, which helped explain the use of ethic singular as kindred to ethos and as contrasted to ethics plural. A global ethic, or rephrased, a moral ethos that is recognizable globally and cross-culturally, offers a minimal foundation that can serve as the basis for the dialogical articulation and defense of a more full-fledged ethics, which would ground the conception of the common good. Despite at times radical dissension about moral norms and values and over against the prevailing politics of violence and economies of accumulation, Pate argues that a global ethic can aid the construal of a common global good and empower transformation towards it. But he cautions, quote, whether or not there is any good that can properly be called common in a global sense remains an open question. The District 6 Museum, as well as the Parliament's global ethic, suggests shelter, food, and safety from violence as basic goods. But tyranny and totalitarianism and the bulldozers of the status quo still threaten. The challenge is not only theoretical and dialogical for articulating these goods. The challenge is not only whether and how a moral framework can be constructed by critical dialogue and consensus building, but also at the level of even recognizing the same basic morality and thus one's accountability to it. As Pate writes, the realities of the poorest are not even conceivable to the richest, and their experience has been engineered to avoid direct contact with the alternate reality of the impoverished. To what extent does the possibility of seeing the breadth and depth of these global realities already require some sort of spiritual discipline, even conversion, some sort of religious imaginary of others as human? I take his third point to be that the current status quo of global capitalism itself has a quasi-religious character. In the quote from Harvey Cox's commentary on Pope Francis's encyclical, this is clear, and I didn't read this, but Cox says, only when we have seen it for what it is can we appreciate the profound challenge the market faith poses and the depth and scope of our global crisis. In other words, to phrase it in historically Christian terms, it is a matter of false faith that in turn leads to false understanding. The dangers to human flourishing and ecological sustainability are such that market faith cannot simply take its place alongside other faiths in a consensus-building dialogue about a global ethic and a common good. Rather, this isn't exactly what you say, but it's an implication. Rather, this quasi-religion must be confronted through prophetic critique and resisted. A global ethic can be interpreted as a form of prophetic critique. I want to suggest, in addition, that this interpretation mobilizes ambiguous resources within Judaism and Christianity, and especially within liberal Protestantism. Although the paper's definition of prophetic comes from Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel, this is the most overtly and indeed Protestant part of the paper. In fact, Paul Tillich referred, who's quoted, and all of this wasn't read, referred to what is here interpreted as the prophetic principle as the Protestant principle in Tillich's influential articulation. I note this not to disregard the Hebrew prophets or other forms of prophetic action and protest, but to further contextualize potential resources and their limits. A critique of idolatry has undergirded and fueled Protestant protest for good and for ill. Capitalism is not the first global system that Protestant Christians have protested. Luther took on the papacy, thundering God alone. Calvinist Protestants sharpened their critique against the French Catholic monarchy. And each of those forms were rooted in the critique of idolatry that is the blade that sharpened the emergence of monotheism. At its best, this call to resist idolatry is not merely to revolt from authority, constraint, or human frailty. It is to push back against evil and harm, rejecting the sovereignty of alien powers, as the Barman Declaration put it, and repelling destructive constrictions of self, other, and world. I've written about a sensibility of fundamental protest that I see as one of the wellsprings of Protestant faith. It's a kind of orienting religious experience, in a sense. It's not the way that all Protestants would talk about protest as a religious sensibility, but I think doing so helps us to see that there's a positive content to protest. I've talked especially about three interrelated protests. One, resistance to idolatry proper, to a constricted sense of the divine and of divine goodness and justice. Two, a resistance to constricted views of humanity and a resistance to the degradation of life. And three, a critique of theology's own idolatries. I've been instructed in thinking about this notion of Protestant principle by H. Richard Niebuhr's formulation of it more than Paul Tillich's. And what I like about Niebuhr's interpretation is that he always holds it in a polarity with Catholic substance. It's not that Tillich doesn't do that either, but the way that Niebuhr construes polarity is that it's a mutually energizing dialectic and I think that's a helpful way, perhaps, to approach that. And I wonder even if that might be implicitly underneath Professor Pate's discussion of the common good in relation to the prophetic principle, that each, in fact, can operate like a mutually corrective polarity. The language of idolatry, per se, I didn't find in the Parliament's global ethic, but I want to, in concluding, call your attention to the ways in which a similar dialectic of prohibition, affirmation, attraction, aversion, affirmation and critique are found throughout the global ethic. And let me just point to two quick examples and then I'm done. Look at each section of the directive. It begins, numberless men and women of all that affirm something. And then another sentence or two down, it will say, nevertheless, all over the world we find. And the directive itself then gets framed also in this kind of approach, aversion. You shall not steal, you shall deal honestly. I think that's a point at which Protestant Christianity can connect with its historic engagement of critique, but that also the document itself pushes back toward Protestants to think more broadly yet than a simple, blunt critique of idolatry, which, as we know, can be both powerful and dangerous.
We have about 15 minutes for conversation. Yes, not so much pose a question, to make an observation. And that is, it seems to me that you start with trying to build almost a conceptual argument within which to look at the global ethic, where I took you to be trying to unfold a logic within the global ethic. Could the two of you talk about that? I mean, to what extent is the global ethics informing how we're looking at these issues? And to what extent is it merely you're trying to use it as a springboard or to develop the conditions under which the global ethic could be operating?
Well,
can you go
ahead?
Room here?
Is the microphone on? Okay.
In my case, I always approach the question of global ethic with a degree of skepticism and pessimism.
I mean, Parliament's global.
The Parliament's particular version of it, but then sort of the wider project of trying to articulate what that means, precisely because of this sense of dissensus that I see with respect to sort of global moral discourse. It's hard for me to envisage a set of circumstances where a global ethic can be, in a substantive sense, embraced. So whenever I have to approach the topic, I have to think about it from the perspective of what would have to be true in order for this global ethic to be operative as a normative resource. And so from that point of view, I think you'd be quite accurate to say that, you know, I'm interested in sort of thinking through the question of what would those conditions have to be, which is why I tend to think of the global ethic less as the underlying structure from which morality as it already exists arises, but rather as a particular standpoint and a sort of a plea for the embrace of a particular kind of morality which can become global, right, rather than one which is sort of kind of already underlyingly implicit.
I guess I would say, first of all, I'm a theologian, not an ethicist, and so I was coming at this in terms of those theological resources that might more supplement than counter what you're doing. I'm very sympathetic to what you're doing. Although I found myself in reading through just being very aware of the ways in which liberal Protestants also say, we're going to do something prophetic, or that's a prophetic action, and it without giving it a lot of content. And so trying to think through that oversimplification of what a prophetic principle often becomes, that it itself substitutes for this important working out of, well, what is a covenant? What is it?
Exactly. That's where I think that a global ethic can be a resource for apathetic critique precisely because it brings content to the conversation and says, if we're going to be prophetic, here are some things to be prophetic about, right, and on behalf of. And then further substantive policy considerations can be drawn from that.
Okay, let's turn to the audience. We always allow a student to ask the first question. So, Mr. Pinckney, in the back.
Just following up on what you said earlier, there seems to be a competing logic that we've been talking about today, sort of this Pharaoh's logic of war and apartheid and domination. I think I'm having trouble seeing how prophetic critique can work against systemic violence and starvation, things like that. So I'm wondering how we get teeth to global ethics, where it does act as a check to predatory capitalism, where it doesn't just say this is wrong, but actually has the ability to impose ethics on a system that doesn't seem to have.
For me, that's the $40,000 question. And especially, I left some things I wound up on the cutting floor from my original version of the paper, which you got, but which I wasn't able to include because I was running like more than 1,000 words over, right? So I had to cut a number of things out. One of the things that was on my mind was precisely the idea of sort of Tillich's articulation of the concept of Kairos in the interwar years. And the idea that one of the things he was articulating at that time is, if we cannot at this moment find a way to sort of embrace that Kairos, right? Embrace that sort of prophetic stance against the, you know, the kind of dehumanizing forces that are besetting our society, then what comes next is going to be a lot worse. And as it turns out, what came next was a lot worse. And I think that much the same thing applies today. I mean, the question of giving teeth to a global ethic, I think, has to be about the question of being willing to, you know, forthrightly stand up and articulate this as an alternative, right? Which requires us to say no to certain things about value systems that are widely embraced or at least taken for granted within the context of a global economy, right? And so if we don't do that, then I think we are in another situation such as in the interwar years where that Kairos can pass us by. Right? There's no guarantee that just because we exist in a Kairos moment, as I would like to claim we do, that we will embrace that Kairos. Kairos can pass. Right? And so if we can't speak out about these things in a way that genuinely presents them as an alternative, and in a way that's persuasive to people, then what comes next could be a lot worse.
My issue here is credibility. It seems to me that what's being argued for here in terms of a pathetic stance over against our situation is whether a pathetic or critical stance assumes a transcendent God, which I would argue is no longer true. That our explanation of our existence is completely natural, but that's the future. And therefore, whether this kind of critique really has substance and then it has some real credibility in terms of its foundation. And whether instead we find the basis for prophecy within nature itself, that is, the possibility of death, that our incapacity for continued life is itself a prophetic stance that requires human action that includes all of nature, something like that.
Either one.
I feel the last one, but I'd like to respond to this as well. I just think, first of all, I'll cop to the fact that, you know, I still find value. Sorry, I'll move a little bit closer. I'll cop to the fact that I still find value in the concept of a transcendent God. So I'm still latching onto that concept. However, I think that what I'm articulating here can be read in terms of forms of religious naturalism. I think, and I think the way that you articulated it was really well said. And I think that
think that whether or not you view sort of that wellspring of divinity that I'm describing in the paper as emerging from, you know, from something which transcends all possible experience, or, you know, or is revealed in particular religious texts, or even among all religious texts, or whether you see it as ultimately emerging from nature itself, I think the larger issue is whether or not wherever that source of religious significance comes from, whether or not it does provide a sort of motivation for that form of prophetic critique.
One of the reasons why I use that quote from the District 6 Museum that uses this pretty strong language about defilement is that I think that experience of defilement is also in that affective dimension of approach and aversion can do some of the grounding of that kind of critique, but it also needs to be framed in terms of not only a sense of no, but a sense of yes, and of this mutually shaping dialectic of this is good and this is defiling. I'm suspicious of too quickly moving to a transcendent basis for prophetic critique, just because of also the ambiguity of what happens when someone is, when that critique is raised to that level of, it's a holy war, I think there's lots of reasons to rethink any use of that, and for those number of reasons, especially.
This gentleman right back here has been waiting.
I don't want to raise a really hard question about the relationship between Christianity and ethics that is essential to your talk. And I think the question is inevitable, because I think at least two great sociologists, Max Weber and Dick Durkheim, take Christianity as the foundation of capitalism. A Christian values, moral individualism, Calvinist ethics, they are the foundation of ethics, of a modern society as a capitalist system. And this is not only believed in kind of the West, it is believed in China as well. And Chinese people now think that we're not capitalist enough because we're not Christians. Right? And we're not accepting the Christian values because that's the fundamental reason we're not adopting the Christian value enough. That is why we're not capitalistic enough. Right. So this is a big question here, in the sense of in what sense did this concept of freedom and equality taken to be a prophetic kind of meaning, and to both capitalism per se, or it is economic system or moral values. And in this sense, I understand how pessimistic we can be, not only you. Right? And, but in what sense there is an element of self-critique as articulated by Kuhn and you, in the sense that Christian self-critique of the moral value of capitalist economic order, or all the kind of social values, or kind of a general kind of human values.
Let's take one more question. Professor Miller has been waiting, and then your response to both of them will have to be answered.
Yeah, I have an observation about the ethic itself that I'd like to hear you speak about. And that's vis-a-vis your interest in Kairos and your worries about incommensurability, as you know, you're talking. And that's the language of crisis that is part of those opening paragraphs, right? And it seems to me that the ethic is launched on the view that we are in deep trouble, and this trouble is global.
Yeah.
Okay? And that's a universal too, right? It's not that the universals are only at the level of the moral values, but that we're in a shared situation. And I think there is a kind of confidence that naming these problems is itself kind of self-evident, right? And that, you know, whatever postmodern skepticisms one might cultivate are actually embarrassed by this shared sense of crisis, and that itself can serve A, as a kind of legitimation for the document, and also to inject a sense of urgency on par with the kind of kairos that you were mentioning earlier. So I just invite your thoughts about that.
Well, I think that's very well said. I think that certainly, the idea that we're in the midst of a crisis and we're all in this boat together, right? And then if the boat goes down, we all go down with it, ought to motivate a very sincere moral introspection about how we should act and how we should organize our society. And I think what the Declaration does very well is to identify those needs. And then I turn around and I see when you look at the specific elements of the nature of that crisis, growing inequality, ecological degradation, increasing violence and ethno-nationalism, what I don't see, and this is what concerns me, is I don't see everybody recognizing that we're in the same boat. Rather, what I see is people saying, no, I deny that I'm in this boat with you. Right? Now the fact is I see we're in the boat, you see we're in the boat, but then I see people saying, no, global warming isn't real. Right? I see people saying, well, no, ethno-nationalism isn't a real crisis. I see people crying fake news. Right? And then I say, well, they live in an alternative reality to me, in which case the relevance of this global ethic is simply not going to be apparent to them in the way that it's apparent to me. I think just to say really quickly, I think that the element of self-critical Christianity is absolutely necessary and is there implicit in what I'm trying to articulate. Were there world enough in time, I definitely would have spent some time articulating that in the paper.
Let us thank our speakers.
Of giving a brief final word, if I'm correct on this? Yes? Okay. As you know, I'm William Schweiger. I teach theological ethics here at the University of Chicago. I thank you all for coming today and for your diligence and patience in staying the day and in hearing all these rich papers. I want to begin these brief comments with a word of thanks to Dean Zoloth of the Divinity School and Professor Wilhelmine Otten, Director of the Martin Marty Center for Public Understanding of Religion, for hosting the event. I thank again all of the students who have helped make this event possible by taking on so many tasks. Thanks also to Larry Greenfield, who heads the ongoing work of the Parliaments of World's Religion. And first and foremost, Miriam Ngo, who we owe her a profound debt of gratitude for her tireless effort, persistence, and foresight in conceiving and executing this wonderful and important event. I think we should give her a round of applause. My gratitude expressed, I want to do a few things in the time allotted to me. First, I want to note and distinguish, if not separate, two forms of global ethics, of which they've been noted in different ways today. And I also want to underscore, despite some of my own criticisms of it, the singular importance methodologically of the Parliament's global ethics. And second, I will enumerate some themes that came out today that I hope will continue into our discussion tomorrow. What we've heard today are lectures that weave together or treat separately two distinct forms, distinct but not separate forms of global ethics, one distinctly religious, represented by the Parliament's ethics, and another, if we can put it this way, broadly philosophical. While these forms of global ethics aim at understanding peace and social justice among the world's peoples, the resources they use, how they justify their claims, and the problems they face are related but distinct. These three points are reflected in the principles of the Parliament's global ethics, where we read, quote, "We are persons who have committed ourselves to the precepts and practices of the world's religions. We confirm that there is already a consensus among the religions which can be the basis of a global ethic, a minimal fundamental consensus concerning binding values, irrevocable standards, and fundamental moral attitudes, unquote. That is to say, the resources of the Parliament's ethic are claimed to be internal to the world's religions, but the warrant or justification of the ethic is the confirmed consensus among the religions, a confirmation enacted by the Parliament's representatives. Insofar as that is the case, then the problem faced by the Parliament's ethics are first practical ones, that is, how to live out and practice the commitment to this ethic, and second, the need to assess and interpret the religions in search for the consensus that in fact warrants the ethic. It seems to me that most of the debate about the Parliament's ethic, is it really Western or is it really a version of Christian and maybe Jewish ethics? Can a Parliament of representatives of religions really provide sufficient warrant for an ethic when the religions rely on different warrants for their own moral thought? Those are very typical criticisms of the global ethic. The real issue is the connection between the religious consensus and what warrants or justifies an ethic. I'm going to return to this point in a moment as a crucial and indispensable contribution to the Parliament's ethics, to the debate about global ethics more generally. Now, the other form of a global ethics, what I broadly call the philosophical one, faces many of the same problems, but ironically has a decided disadvantage. I know that claim will sound strange to many who think that the best way forward in a pluralistic and diverse world is to jettison all forms of discourse nested in natural languages and various cultures, including religious traditions, and to seek some generally neutral moral communication. Except for the quasi-utopic idea of an ideal theory advanced by some philosophers, this strategy is, hermeneutically speaking, a non-starter. That is, insofar as human beings are linguistic, social, and historical beings, we cannot escape our traditions, even if we are also not trapped within them, since we can understand people with different languages, different societies, and different histories. That is, given the very nature of human understanding, we must take a hermeneutical turn in our moral thinking. We have to interpret traditions of which we are a part. So the tactic of developing a global ethics from an ideal theoretical standpoint is doomed to problems and perhaps even failures because of the very nature of human understanding itself. This is why appeals to human rights as a moral lingua franca is encumbered, because come what may, we cannot escape our natural languages, French or otherwise. My point then is that the second strategy of founding a global ethics on ostensibly culturally neutral philosophical grounds is, on my reading, doomed to failure, unless it is undertaken through a hermeneutic of cultural and religious forms. And this means that the Parliament's ethic, despite its many problems, actually advances the work of global ethics on two important fronts. First, the Parliament of World Religions Global Ethics commits us to hermeneutical moral reflection, that is, understanding through interpretation, wherein we must, come what may, interpret the resources of actual moral traditions in the search for shared human commonalities, some shared consensus. This is, of course, an unending task, since all too often traditions insist not simply on their distinctiveness as human traditions, but their supposed absolute uniqueness in human experience.
a global ethic can grant distinctiveness, it must challenge appeals to uniqueness. On the grounds of our shared humanity, something that has come up over and over today. Now, this first point leads to a second one. The real force of the Parliament's global ethics is to force the religions to ask a painful and very pointed question, raised both inside the traditions and outside of them, and to be realistic about our actual social condition. Here's the question. Do you affirm in the very core of your convictions that we are all, despite our profound differences, members of one vulnerable, fallible species, and therefore can and must and may share moral wisdom and moral aspirations within a shared world? If not, then one leaves the community of human suffering and hoping beings for the supposed sanctity of one's own tradition. One negates the possibility of shared moral learning. One negates the possibility of an emergent new religious humanism, if I can put it that way. Now, by posing this question, the Parliament's global ethics is a valuable document whose directives matter as much today as they did when they were first written 25 years ago. In fact, maybe more so. The sessions we've heard today, it seems to me, nuance and put substance to that pointed question that the Parliament's ethic is raising. In our first session on Buddhism, we saw the ways in which engaged Buddhist thought and its concern for networking and respect, backing egalitarianism, could be seen as arising out of a particular interpretation, an on-the-ground and lived interpretation of dependent co-origination within that tradition itself. So using a source within the religious tradition to transform itself and engage others. In our second session on Shia Islam, we entered into the problem of authority, both epistemic and moral, to raise the question of from whence do moral norms come and what authorizes them. Our third session on Judaism explored the complexities of human or Jewish identity and responsibility against the backdrop of a conception of authentic humanity. While Jewish thinkers are suspicious of universals, there seems to be, at least as I heard the lecture today, the concern to enunciate Jewish identity in relationship to a shared authentic human identity. Our fourth session on Hindu thought explored equality, fraternity, and liberty, but within, and this is very important, I think, for our ongoing discussion, as I mentioned in the time of the lecture, three different perspectives on looking at the social embeddedness of any ethics. All three, it seems to me, are operative in every religious tradition. The question is how they can be mutually motivated to critique each other, those three being kind of metaphysical or theological perspective on the social order, canonical stories or scriptures which both embed a social order and can be used to criticize it, and then actual human life as we find it now. Pulling those apart lead too easily to the problem of ideology. And so it seems to me that the three need to operate together. Finally, in our discussion of Christianity, which we just heard, it began with the question, the pointed question of what is going on, but was really asking about how to validate a global ethics for the common good when we cannot assume shared moral norms to begin with. The argument there trafficked between these two types of global ethics that I noted, at least I think it did, by arguing first for dialogical interaction to enable the emergence of shared values. In that sense, its prophetic stance was not transcendent. It actually arises or emerges within the dialogue among religions. And then with Christine Culp's work, distinctive Protestant contribution to make sure that we have a moment of self-critique within all religions. The prophetic, the protesting moment of the contribution of Protestant Christianity to its own tradition. I see these various issues, how to work against the habits that impede cultural development, the nature of authority, complex identities and their relationship to responsibility, the question of social structures that either impede or enhance the possibility of a global ethics, and finally the question of dialogue, the emergence of values and protest. I see all of those aspects of our discussion today as ways of refining the force of the global ethics question about the commitment of religious people to the possibility of affirming these values of the ethics itself. And with that, I think we are concluded. And we will see you in the morning at 9 o'clock. Thank you very much, and thank you for coming.